The early week optimism didn't last long as rebounding energy prices dampened the investor mood on Monday. Technology stocks remained under a decent negative pressure before the earnings announcement as some big US banks boost their dividend to stop sell-off. So welcome, this is Swissquote's daily market talk. So optimism didn't last long yesterday and the market mood turned rapidly sour as the news flow was not pointing at sustained gains. Anyway, oil and commodity prices rebounded yesterday with the escalation of tensions in Ukraine. Plus, United Arab Emirates Energy Minister said yesterday that they are actually pumping near maximum capacity based on their quota of around 3 million barrels per day under the agreement with the OPEC Plus, confirming actually the French President Emmanuel Macron's worry that the United Arab Emirates and Saudi Arabia, which were perceived as the only two countries in the OPEC that have spare capacity to produce more, can barely increase their oil production. In addition, the unrest in Libya and in Ecuador hints that they may not pump to meet their quotas as well, which could further tighten the global oil supply. And well, the US strategic petroleum reserves fell to the lowest level since April 1986. So the supply news are not encouraging at all. On the political front, well, the G7 leaders now want to put a price cap on Russian oil in order to limit the Russian profits from surging oil prices. On the other hand, the discussions between Iran and the US resumed this week, giving some people hope that this time we could see material progress in these nuclear talks, which could then lead to the end of the sanctions against the Iranian oil that would unlock additional barrels for the global oil supply and help easing pressure on oil prices, hopefully. And well, Joe Biden clearly has to gain by moving forward with a nuclear deal with Iran, but it remains complicated. The last time the two countries have come this close to a deal, the talks had stalled, and that was in March this year. So all in all, the barrel of American crude trades past $112 level this morning, and that keeps the concerns of high inflation tight again in the markets. The US 10-year yield jumped more than 2% yesterday to 3.20% level, and the US indices, which started the session in the positive, ended up in the red. The S&P 500 slid 0.30% and closed the session at 3,900 level, while Nasdaq was the most heavily hit with a 0.70% loss as technology stocks were again on the chopping block. But the index managed actually to close just above the 12,000 mark. So what now? Sitting now lower is year-end target for the S&P 500 to 4,200 from 4,700 previously, saying that better than feared earnings and signs of peaking interest rates combined with the bearish investor position and should actually still support a positive risk-reward setup in the second half of this year and encourage some recovery at least in stock prices. JP Morgan analysts, on the other hand, says that, well, the world is not in great shape, that's for sure, but the fact that an average investor now expects an economic disaster actually opens the door for a decent rebound possibility if the disaster doesn't happen, of course. And well, a latest Bloomberg survey actually hinted that after a historical plunge, stocks and bonds are probably not from bottoming out, while on the other hand, an analyst at Morgan Stanley actually highlighted that economists have actually begun cutting their growth forecast, but the company analysts are still sitting there like deer in headlights, doing just nothing about their own forecast. So the second quarter earnings will be obviously crucial for the market mood again, and only strong earnings could stop the bleeding in the stock markets, especially in the technology stocks. Now, the latest 13F filing from Jefferies shows that the managers of large cap funds have never been this underweight in technology stocks. They actually cut their positions of around 9% in the second quarter of this year. The money rather was allocated to materials energy, healthcare, and financials. For now, the top five technology stocks held by large cap funds are Microsoft. More than 93% of funds have Microsoft in their portfolios. Amazon with 92% of them holding Amazon shares. Nvidia with 84.5%. Facebook, so Meta, with near 77%. And Apple, which is present in around 76% of these large cap portfolios. So these stocks remain very, very much vulnerable to changes in Federal Reserve expectations and interest rates. Of course, Amazon, for example, fell below its long-term trend line this quarter, even though the $100 psychological level now plays in favor of a potentially sustainable rebound, as an Amazon share below the $100 per barrel level sounds just too cheap to investors nowadays. Microsoft, on the other hand, fell below a major Fibonacci support in May, which is a 38.2% retracement on post-pandemic rally, which stands near $265 per share, and which calls for further sell-off toward the $240 a share if the share price cannot consolidate above that $265 level in the near term. Apple, on the other hand, has tested its 38.2% Fibonacci support on the post-pandemic rally. That's near $131 level and should keep above this level to remain in the long-term bullish trend. The actual levels in technology stocks could actually be interesting for some dip buyers if these companies could prove that they did, or they do, fairly good in an environment of rising inflation and, of course, rising rates. It is hard but not impossible, so that's good news. Nike, for example, topped Wall Street earnings and sales expectations in the latest quarter, but still the shares fell near 3% in the after-hours trading as they highlighted challenges such as higher transportation costs, for example, and longer shipping times that remain persistent and challenging. So investors still focus on the problems rather than on the good news. Now, one sector that was supposed to benefit from higher interest rates was financials, but we only saw the bank shares dive this year. But despite challenges, well, the good news is that the big US banks have solid fundamentals. This is what the stress test results confirmed last week. So some of these big US banks just announced that they are increasing their dividends in response to their success in clearing this year's stress test. In this sense, Morgan Stanley announced a $20 billion worth of share buyback and a dividend increase from 70 to 77.5 cents. Goldman said it will boost its quarterly dividend by 25%, and JP and Citi said that they will keep their dividends unchanged. So let's see if better dividends from the US big banks could actually lead to a turnaround in bank stocks in the second half of this year. Now, Goldman shares have slipped into the bearish consolidation zone after clearing a major Fibonacci support earlier this year on the post-pandemic rally, and it actually needs solid quarterly earnings reports to keep its head above that $300 psychological mark. In the FX markets, well, we have no major action. The US dollar index consolidates a touch below the 104 mark as the euro dollar is again testing the 50-day moving average to the upside. The European Central Bank meets this week in a Jackson Hole-like meeting, and well, investors will be looking for any hint of how the Europeans are now planning to fight inflation in Europe without, however, triggering a fresh debt crisis in the middle of the Eurozone. We will certainly hear hawkish comments from the European Central Bank officials this week, but what investors really want to know is more details about that upcoming entire fragmentation instrument, which is crucial if the ECB wants to catch up its major peers in raising the interest rates. The Bank of Japan, on the other hand, bought an incredible amount of JGBs last week. I don't know if you saw that, and that was to maintain their yield steady as the pressure on US and the European yields puts pressure on the Japanese yields as well, and huge pressure apparently. As a result, the BOJ now holds more than 50% of the Japanese government debt on its balance sheet. What a joke, really. Some people now believe that the BOJ will soon be unable to control its yield curve and just let the yields move higher with the rest of the world, in which case we could finally see some easing in the dollar JPY, which seems to be losing momentum above the $135 level. If that's the case, we could actually see a quite a rapid correction to the downside in dollar yen, which would immediately send the pair to and perhaps below the 50-day moving average, which now stands near the $130 level. So this is all for today. I'm Ipek Özkardeşkaya, and thank you for joining me. I hope this episode of Market Talk has been helpful and it has been insightful to you. So please do not hesitate to leave your comments, your reactions, and your questions below as usual, and follow us on Instagram, on Twitter, and on LinkedIn for regular market updates. And subscribe, of course, to our YouTube channel for daily market comments. I meet you again tomorrow, and until then, good day trading.